Hello, I'm happy to be here. What I'd like to do today is give you a little bit of the flavor of some of the amazing things that are happening in artificial intelligence. And things are happening incredibly quickly with this technology. In fact, some of what I'll talk about has just happened. Some of it happened yesterday, and a lot of it has been happening the last few months. Just sort of one little sign that something's going on is all the big tech companies, IBM, Google, Apple, eBay, Facebook, they've all created artificial intelligence and robotics laboratories in the last few years, and billions of dollars of investment are going into these research labs. Why are these companies doing this? There's a consulting firm called McKinsey who did an analysis of the technological trends over the next 10 years, and they determined that in the next 10 years, AI, artificial intelligence, and robotics are likely to create $50 trillion of value. Now, this is massive. Just to sort of compare it, the entire gross domestic product of the United States is $18 trillion. And so we have a massive economic force coming into the world over the next decade. So how does it work, and you know, how do we understand it? The only intelligent system we know of is the human brain. The human brain has about 86 billion neurons. Neurons are the cells that actually do the thinking that people do. And these cells, these neurons, are connected in a very complicated network that people are calling the connectome. And neuroscientists are busily working away to figure out how are all these neurons connected together. Computer scientists saw this back in 1957. There was a guy named Frank Rosenblatt who said, well, maybe we can make a digital or a software version of these neurons, and maybe we can make software programs that can think. So he created something he called the Perceptron. And basically, the way a neuron works is it has little fibers called dendrites that receive signals from other neurons, combines them in some way, and creates a signal that goes down the axon to trigger other neurons. And it's that process which leads our brains to think. So Rosenblatt's Perceptron was a similar thing. It had a bunch of inputs. Each input had a weight, combined those inputs by weighted by these weights, and produced an output. And the magical thing about the Perceptron was that he was able to train it to perform desirable functions. And this got people really excited back in the 1950s. There's a great quote. This is going to be the embryo of an electronic computer that the Navy expects will be able to walk, talk, see, write, and reproduce itself and be conscious of its own existence. Took things a little bit longer than they thought, maybe, but there was clearly very high hopes here. People experimented with this kind of system, and it did some good things, not quite, you know, being conscious of its own existence, but, you know, made progress. And by 1986, people had figured out how to take whole networks of these perceptron-like units, these little artificial neurons, and make neural networks. And there was an algorithm called backpropagation, which allowed people to have three layers of these neurons and to train them on training sets. And they began to use this kind of network to learn how to recognize speech, for example. And it had some progress. People were excited in the 1980s, but it didn't really revolutionize the world. In 2007, technology advanced. We got much faster computers. We have a lot more training data. The entire internet, the web, serves as a training data. And people figured out how to have more layers and how to do training effectively. And something was christened deep learning. So these are neural networks that have many, many layers, sometimes 10 layers, sometimes as many as 100 layers. Typically, they have some input, like this is a network that maybe takes a picture of somebody and tries to guess what their age is, takes the pixels of that picture, sends it into the first layer. That first layer does some things, layer after layer after layer, and eventually the output, it says what their age is. By giving it lots and lots of examples, sometimes millions of examples, it's able to train this, and it actually becomes a pretty good predictor. Deep learning had tremendous successes over the past, 5 years or so, in speech recognition, in recognizing images, discriminating between dogs and cats, in drug discovery, figuring out new drugs, determining the sentiment of a sentence, like when you read a review of a movie, is that a positive review or a negative review? And sometimes it's complicated because people speak ironically, like, oh yeah, that movie was great, ha ha ha. That's a negative review. Image captioning, putting labels on images, translating from one language to another one, playing video games. All of these were dramatic improvements over what people had been able to do previously, and in many cases, they achieved performance better than what people could do on these tasks. So that generated massive interest. And in fact, just last year, there are over 300 startup companies devoted to using deep learning for a bunch of different tasks that received more than $1.5 billion of investment. So there's massive, massive effort going into this these days. And I'd like to kind of go through some of the applications where this kind of technology is going to transform many aspects of society. The first one that many people think of when you think about artificial intelligence is robots. And the primary use of robots today is in manufacturing. So why would you want a robot doing manufacturing in a factory? Well, for one thing, they'll work 24 hours a day. They don't need breaks. They don't need food. They don't need medical care. They don't quit. They don't get bored. They don't get depressed. They're willing to work anywhere. It's an interesting piece because as factories become more robotic, they may very well move back to a lot of the manufacturing in the United States moved to Asia because the labor was cheaper. If the labor is being done by robots, it may move back to where the markets are. And so we could see big shifts in where factories are located. They're happy to work in hazardous environments. They don't leak secrets, you know, how things are designed. They're sometimes secret for a company. They work well with others. There's no fighting, infighting. Once you've got a robot that does what you want, you've trained it to do something really well, you can make a copy of it. And so they have a lot of benefits to a company. In December, just a few weeks ago, the Japanese robot company Fanuc used this deep learning idea, this neural network, to train one of their robots to be able to pick parts out of a bin using a camera to look at it and figure out what part to take and lift up the part. This is called bin picking, very challenging problem that people have worked for decades on. They claim to be able to do that in 8 hours, 8 hours of training, and now they have a robot that can do that. There are now 420 Chinese robot companies. So China is moving into robots in a very, very big way. There are 1,500 factories in the Dongguan region of China, which are undergoing what they call a robot replace human program, where currently you have a factory with an assembly line with lots and lots of people working. They are replacing all the people by robots. The first few factories that they've done this with have dramatically improved productivity, quality, and all sorts of things. So there's a big program there. Of course, this raises social questions. What do all the people that used to work in factories do now? And that's a big issue that a lot of people are talking about. In March of last year, the president of Baidu is sort of the Chinese version of Google, doing very similar kinds of things. The president of Baidu said that China should really have a state-sponsored China Brain project to develop full artificial intelligence as smart as people, and he said it should be kind of comparable to the Apollo space program in the US in the 1960s. And so that's a sort of indication that China is very serious about moving forward in this direction. Another area that's just sort of getting going is self-driving cars. If you drive on the freeway around here, sometimes you'll see them. These cars with a little thing on the roof. And today, there's usually a person behind the steering wheel, but they often don't have their hands on the steering wheel. So the car is sort of driving itself. And this is potentially extremely disruptive. It's predicted that these kinds of vehicles could create $10 trillion of value by 2025. And they could potentially disrupt the car dealer networks today, insurance markets, parking, car finance, the trucking industry, semi-trucks. It's kind of tiring and boring for a person to have to drive those. If they can drive themselves, that could be much better. 10 million jobs are involved in that kind of transportation. So Google was sort of one of the innovators in that area. We've been seeing Google self-driving cars driving on the roads around here for quite some time. But now every other company is getting into it. There's these secret self-driving cars that don't have any label on them, and people follow them, and they go into the Apple parking lot. So it seems like Apple is probably working on it. Tesla recently released a software upgrade to some of their electric cars that put them in autopilot mode, which means that they can do 90% of the driving themselves. Google says that their cars will be ready to be fully self-driving by 2020. Mercedes is working on it, General Motors, Volvo, Apple, and Uber. Uber is an interesting case. Uber is this little startup that basically it's a phone app. It hooks up people that want rides with people who are willing to give them rides. It was at its most recent investment round, it was valued at $70 billion. $70 billion for a phone app. Remarkable. So they are facing a lot of competition, people kind of copying their phone app. And in fact, Google recently said, oh, we're going to make a phone app like that. So Uber is a little bit worried. And so one of their strategies is to, instead of having human drivers, to start using self-driving cars. Currently, Uber takes about 20% of the fare when somebody drives from one place to another. They are the world's largest job creator. About 50,000 new drivers sign up for Uber every month. Very, very remarkable. If they start using self-driving cars, that's going to shift a lot. And so that's an interesting sort of social question. Once Google said, oh, we're going to make an Uber-like app, Uber said, oh my gosh, we better do self-driving cars. We can't rely on Google self-driving cars. So they started a research center to study self-driving cars in Pittsburgh, and they hired the entire robotics factory from Carnegie Mellon to join this lab. Carnegie Mellon was very upset about this. If they are successful, some people have done analyses, the way it would work with a self-driving Uber is you say, oh, I want to ride somewhere. It takes about 36 seconds of wait. It'll cost you about 50 cents a mile, and Uber will get 100% of the fares. If that's correct, then probably people won't buy cars anymore. It becomes a much better proposition to always use an Uber rather than have your own car, and you can have the car appropriate for the thing. If you just want to get something at the supermarket, you might have a little car. If you want to haul a bunch of stuff, you might get a big car. If you've got a long journey, you might have a different kind of car. And so the whole society could very, very rapidly change from owning cars, which is the common thing today, to a situation in which most cars are self-driving. And most cars today just sit in a parking lot or they sit in your driveway and they don't do anything. With self-driving cars, they can drive all the time, so they much better use of the hardware, and that could dramatically change the way that our society runs. Just yesterday, NVIDIA, they're the company that makes graphics processors for video games, they said, oh, we've just designed a supercomputer for your car to make it do self-driving better, in particular to do deep learning neural nets to help your car drive better. So that's a sort of an amazing development that just came out yesterday. There's all kinds of ethical issues with self-driving cars. Imagine your self-driving car is in the fast lane on the freeway, and there's a truck in front of you with a big load, and something happens, and the back of the truck opens up, and the load falls down on the freeway. So you're about to crash into this load, and it might kill you. But you can move to the next lane over, except there's a motorcyclist there. And if you do that, you're probably going to kill the motorcyclist. Well, which should you do? Should you risk dying yourself, or should you risk killing the motorcyclist? Today, if a person faced that, in the spur of the moment, they would make a decision one way or the other, and we would just say, well, that's just what happened. For a self-driving car, there has to be an algorithm that says, in this situation, what should you do? Should it favor the life of the driver, or should it favor protecting other people? That's a kind of ethical question. And if a programmer made that decision, and let's say it decided to run into the motorcyclist, is the programmer responsible for killing that motorcyclist? So lots and lots of ethical questions like that are starting to come to the fore. One response to that, the Google self-driving cars will typically only drive very slowly, like 25 miles an hour or so, and they're very careful about pedestrians. If there's a pedestrian, they will do everything they can to avoid them. That has led to what some people are calling pedestrian chicken. In Mountain View, you see a Google self-driving car, and if you're a pedestrian, you're about to go in front of it, it'll stop. But then some of these pedestrians, they don't actually go, they back up. Then when the car starts to go, they do it again. And so you kind of mess with the car, and so what do you do about that? So somebody has proposed you put a sound cannon on the top of the car to blast somebody if they're not behaving properly. Who knows? 3D printing is another interesting area. Today, 3D printers make things like plastic cups and so on. But in April of 2014, the Chinese company WinSun 3D printed 10 houses in 24 hours. Now, these houses aren't the most beautiful thing in the world, but hey, they're functional. It's pretty remarkable. Well, last year, the very same company 3D printed this huge 12,000 square foot villa, which actually looks pretty nice. Drones, another big thing. Company NVIDIA, again, together with another company called Kespri, used deep learning to autonomously drive drones. In June of in the summer, you started seeing these weird images. These are deep learning neural nets hallucinating. These are the input that would make them happiest. And so you get these very strange created images. In November of last year, a group created a deep learning neural net that synthesizes images of bedrooms. None of the pictures, none of the bedrooms in this are real. These are images created by this network. It did the same thing for record album covers. So we have a kind of creative activity going on that's very strange. And how is this going to interact in our society? In November of last year, a group created something they call Neural Talk and Walk, where they walked around Amsterdam and live, as they took images of things, their network made little commentary, like this is two guys eating a hot dog. Here's somebody walking along the river and there's a boat. Very remarkable. You can see it on YouTube. So safety issues, many people are starting to think about it. There's a whole slew of new research institutes. I have one locally called Self-Aware Systems, but there are several groups who are considering what is the impact of all this amazing technology on our human society and how do we make sure it's beneficial. If you want to learn more about this, there's tons and tons of free resources on the internet. There's open source software. Google just released their deep learning code for free called TensorFlow. There are a huge number of tutorials out there. There's an online natural language class. There's an online vision course. So very, very interesting area. Tons of job opportunities because there's way more need for this kind of technology than there are people who understand it at all. So it might be something to think about if you're looking to work in the technology area. This is an area that's growing extremely rapidly. So I think the future looks very bright. There's $50 trillion of value that's about to be created in the next decade. There are hundreds of startups working on this. There's billions of dollars of investment. The technology is improving very, very rapidly in its performance. There's very free and cheap software available, lots of people playing with it. The hardware to make this go very quickly is getting better and better, special purpose chips, and that's developing quickly. And there are many, many innovative applications which potentially could really make the world a better place. So thank you.